The tablet is now used in front of me. It can be my friend's computer, it can be my TV. I want to show my mom a big video or pictures that I just took in my trip. I just copy that in my finger and I paste it back to the data. You don't need that USB thumb drive because your body becomes a USB thumb drive. So this is just a simple example. We can keep going on this kind of thing, but let's focus on some of the newer work in some things. So I just mentioned that we are on the verge of when the information is going to change its medium again. And that's what excites me. That's what started my journey of exploration. Some of the work that you have seen, but I will very briefly show you some of my journey in very, very brief, very fast. When I was in India, the biggest problem that I see for technology was the language. Not for people who knows already English, but there are millions of the people in rural India where they cannot interact with digital world. Not because they don't know how to computer, they can know computer, but the English is the language is the problem. So I started working in those days, I call it project observed. And I was the first person who made it possible for mobile phones, in those days mobile phones, to type any Indian language. And that's what Project Mouseless looked like. You can type in multiple languages. And I will tell you one very small story around this. One time I was standing actually on Borivali station, the train station, local train station over here. A guy standing next to me, he suddenly shows me his mobile phone, smart, like the old Nokia phones. And he's saying that, you know, now you can type in Marathi. I cannot tell you that how happy I was. I didn't tell him that I did this thing. But that moment So I would definitely tell you that technology is not all about making people's life better and better, whose life is already better. It's also about enabling the billions of the people around you, the two-thirds of the other world. How can you bring technology to them to make their life better? That's the motto also. It's a very important matter. You should definitely remember. Another small invention happened. I always like watching cartoon networks on TV. My sister always liked watching sports. I know you guys know it's a vice versa. But then, when I was in Palanpur, a small town, we always fight for remote. Like, who is going to watch what? I want to watch cricket and Sim want to watch something else on the TV. I thought we can divide the screen into two parts of the TV. You can watch this side, I watch this side. But that's not the right solution because then you lose some picture. This problem was always in my mind. Even when I went to MIT, this problem was always there, that I used to fight with my sister for this. Somehow I need to solve this, and one time I want to sit down next to her and then watch what she wants to watch and I want to watch what I want to do. Went back to MIT, my lab. I keep experimenting, and finally I innovated a new method that up to 5 people can watch different TV channels on the same screen at the same time. You can watch multiple channels. For example, Samsung and Sony provides this particular feature. It's done by me. Even at that time, imagine someone from Japan comes here in our Mumbai airport. He just wears this particular kind of glasses. In the future, might be a Google Glass or other company's glass. All the signages that he sees, he can see in his own language. So there is a lot of possibilities now you can do with this technology when multiple people can see different content on the same screen at the same time because you are doing time multiplexing over there, right? The innovation keeps going on and on. I also made this small project where I thought, why can you not use paper for connecting to the cloud? So someone writes a piece of a paper, it automatically digitizes. Not only digitizes, but artificial intelligence and natural language processing will understand that what you are writing on this piece of paper and do the effective thing. So if you write a to-do list, it automatically becomes a to-do list. You can search that where I kept my this book, and it shows you that it's in second rack of your office. Right? small, small explosion keep going on and on and made me start to believe that magic is possible. Magic is possible in real life. You can make a pen drawing three-dimensional, yes, possible. So that I made a pen and now you can draw in 3D and you can contour that, windows or doors, whatever you want over. I also thought in early 2004 that why can we not make Google Maps, but Google Map of the physical world. So rather than searching coffee on my map and finding where is Starbucks or where is the next coffee store, I can just put my coffee cup and it will show me where is my coffee. Or you can put any object. You can put your metro card. Or let's say IIT ID. I put my IIT ID and it shows me when is my next class and where it is. So I need to run there. So it's very much possible to recognize physical objects, and that's what the earlier map, the physical map looks like. This was much before Microsoft even introduced Microsoft Surface Table. It keeps going on and on, and I was working with Microsoft. That time, the hometown that I come from, Palanpur, there are a lot of rural area in that, where the porters make actually porter wheel, like they have porter's wheel. They rotate the wheel, they put some clay on top of that, and they make pot out of that, or they make a particular kind of vessels that you need out of clay. I thought, why can I not replicate that experience in virtual world? In virtual world, I take Microsoft Surface Table that time. But what you see in the camera, it's actually Kinect camera. The earlier version of Kinect camera that was inside Microsoft Research. It is understanding my hand movements and I can sculpt any virtual pots. So this kind of small explosion I start and keep doing. This project I work in Japan. 1963, Douglas Engelbert sadly passed away last year, 2013, a great innovator. He invented computer mouse. Just imagine, 50 years before, or more than 50 years before, computer mouse was invented. Even today, we have touch screens and gestures and everything. What do? We put our laptop out, from backpack we get our mouse, computer mouse out and put it, right? So mouse is never going away, in some sense. I thought, why can the mouse not go away? Like, I want to take this challenge. Make Douglas Engelbert's mouse go away in some sense. Not in literal sense, but then I thought, yes, hardware of the mouse can go away. We can make it invisible. And that's what I did in project Mouseless. So what you're seeing, or maybe precisely saying what you're not seeing, is a computer mouse. You can put your hand just next to any laptop, any keyboard, and start using, thinking there is a computer mouse beneath it. It works exactly fine. You can do left click, right click, or when moving your cursor, all the operations that you do with a normal mouse. How does it work? There is a small infrared laser which is coming out from your laptop or the keyboard. It's making an invisible layer. It doesn't make a line or point. It actually makes a layer. And when you put your hand, that layer, you're breaking that layer. You're breaking that layer. And that is captured by the camera, which is an infrared camera, which can be really small in an actual product. So this is how simple a mouseless works. When I was working on this particular project, it was in MIT Media Lab. One of our sponsors of Media Lab, Fujitsu, a laptop manufacturer, is now actually planning to launch their laptops using this particular technology as a part of that. So, if I keep going on and on, what was happening in a lot of my research, and I can keep showing more, but let's break here and show some new work. Our personal computer and physical world was two different worlds in some cases. There is a physical world that we live in, there is a digital world. A lot of people try to mix them too by augmented reality, or we call it mixed realities. Microsoft Surface Table was letting you manipulate that information. It's still connecting near. We started making smart objects, making physical digital together, putting silicon inside objects. Different approaches people started working on. But I thought that why, if we are interested in this digital world, the Twitter and the Facebook and the colorful circles in our computer, why can we not just focus on them rather than making another hardware? We just take those things, take the information. Because information is intangible, you cannot grab it. You cannot say 5 kilograms of data or something like that, right? So we can take that information and paint those pixels around us. Simple, right? If I want to have information about something that I'm looking directly on object, then it will be fine. I don't need to get my computer out, my smartphone out, search for that. In order to do that, I thought of putting a projector. So, projector, project light. I thought of putting a projector on my head. And literally thought, I will put a projector on my head. A friend of mine was making fun of me that, are you really going to do this thing? I said, yes. Very next moment, I took the smallest projector in the market available, put a cut on top of my bike helmet, and put the projector over there. I also placed a small camera in front of me. Because what happened that as soon as I put a projector on my head and I'm going around, now I'm projecting information everywhere. If I'm going to a wall is showing some data, some information, some colors. I want to grab them, I want to touch them. So my camera started understanding what I'm doing because I wrote some software code, computer vision code, to understand what I'm doing. A friend of mine, he was drawing on the wall, any wall. This started going more further and further. The projector started becoming smaller and smaller. It became in a cap rather than a bike helmet. It became a pendant. There are a lot of variations, a lot of iterations happening. And as many of you know, SixthSense device, so that it worked from that crazy idea of putting a projector on your head. is still going on and on. I'm not going to show you again what SixthSense Inventor Award, because many of you are already aware of. But I will just show you very quick that now any object, any physical world can be augmented with data, right? A coffee cup can show you that how much calorie you already consumed in the day, whole day today. This is your third coffee. It can project information on any table when you are interacting in collaboration with many people. It was making a newspaper live, so you can see the live videos on the newspaper. This particular applications of technology where information is becoming part of the real world, that excites us, and that's why it's coming. Now you can see that we can start seeing real life products that is keep doing that. Our smartphone is doing augmented reality. Google is coming up with Google Glass, they might be doing augmented reality. Our Galaxy Gear, for example, can get project information or even see augmented reality data on top of that. So applications of particular this technology goes beyond what we can think of. But there is one fundamental innovation that I want to mention you today. Think carefully. If I say this is my smartphone, like this is my particular big smartphone, right? If I ask you that if I want to make my smartphone as small as a coin, is it possible? Yes, technically there is no limitation. We can go to China and there are a lot of manufacturers. We can ask them, make a smartphone as small as a coin, 1 rupee coin. They can definitely do that. Technology, there is no limitation for those particular things. But the limitation is the human limitation. If we make our Android or iPhones as small as a coin, we will not be able to use it. And that's why we are now going again bigger and bigger. So that's where an interesting thing happening, and that's what I want to tell you. With SixthSense and the innovation that I was working on, that limitation goes away. The device can go as small as invisible. In the future, it can be buttons that you wear somewhere, the button can be over here or wherever it's part of it. Because your interface is as big as a newspaper, if you hold a newspaper, it's as big as a wall, if you stand in front of a wall. It's as big as your palm, if you dial a phone using your palm. More than that, because I have the DNA from this culture, I have seen the need of the technology to people in a mass audience. I didn't want to bring this technology to only one corporation that can make money around that. And specifically that reason, I made this technology open source. Many of even people from here, there are almost 25,000 people right now actively contributing to this particular open source code. What is happening after that? You might ask that, okay, show me an example of what happened after particular this technology. Today I bring one example, this particular example. This person is, his name is David in Brazil. He's a friend of mine. He used himself this particular code, software code, open source code. You can find it on Google, you can just search SixthSense open source and you will find the particular code. What he did is that he replaced the projector with a speaker. So there was a projector, camera, there was a computing which connected to a mobile phone. He replaced that projector with simple $2 speaker. Now what he's doing that David cannot speak. David doesn't have words. But David does sign language to talk to people. The problem is, I cannot understand his sign language. Now what is this modified SixthSense device is doing, that David is doing sign language in front of this device. The camera is understanding his hand gestures, converting that into words, passing that to his mobile phone. So rather than a sixth sense, this is David's missing fifth sense. And that's where the technology power comes. These are only some of the examples, and there are many of them. If you go to the open source code, you'll find people sharing the videos of how they make projects, and you can learn from that a lot. But also myself, also I started working on applying this particular technology in glasses. So one of this particular approach I applied in 2011. I made this augmented reality glasses. Of course, at that time it was bulky because technology was not mature enough. But now we have the very thin version of this particular technology explosive. So what you're seeing over here is augmenting a magazine with a live data on top of that. So it's showing you that what is the price of this particular thing. And you can actually buy it by just touching it directly on top. So this was done.